represented by a Liberal member of Parliament, Ralph Goodale. And a promise that we heard repeatedly from the Liberals during the last election campaign and since was that 2015 would be the last election conducted under the first-past-the-post voting system. So when the new government came to power, we had this extensive consultation process of the new system that would replace first-past-the-post. And Regina became a bit of a hub for public consultations on electoral reform. The town hall that I hosted at the museum attracted about 200 people. The Minister of Democratic Institutions chose Regina as the one place in Saskatchewan that she visited as part of her consultations. And the Democratic Reform Committee of the House of Commons kicked off its national tour right here in Regina. Now, the vast majority of people who participated in those consultations, both here in Regina and across the country, favored a proportional voting system to ensure that every vote would count equally. Now, the Liberal government has a majority of seats in the House of Commons, despite the fact that it garnered only about 39% of the popular vote. So the Liberals were not particularly keen on a proportional voting system. And indeed, what they've announced is that they're going to not only disregard all of those consultations, they're going to disregard the promise that they made and stick with the first-past-the-post voting system. So in response to that, our Democratic Reform critic, Nathan Cullen, has started a cross-country Keep Your Promise tour to try to help remind the Liberals about the promise that they made. And so without further ado, please give a warm welcome to Nathan Cullen.
Good evening, everybody. How are you doing?
Oh, all right.
Oh, good. Hopefully we'll be together for a little bit, and maybe by the end you'll be even better. I'm not making any promises, and I'm so glad Aaron has occupied the front row. The church I went to as a kid, actually the front row unbolted and could be moved because the priest got so sick of the front rows being empty that once the church would fill up, they bolt them out and move them down and you became the front row. One quick correction on the visual that you're looking at right now. We went to Edmonton. There's always a few Albertans in the crowd that say, what the hell happened with Edmonton? Oh, I got a sock knock. Are we in a church? We're in a church, right? I gotta try not to curse. Okay, I'll do my best. So, as Aaron said, I'm Nathan Cullen. I'm the Member of Parliament from a place called Skeena, Bulkley Valley. Doesn't exactly roll off the tongue, but is what it lacks in beauty in its name, it makes up for in the place itself. I'll show you where it is. I represent this part of British Columbia. Right from the northern tip of Vancouver Island all the way up to the Yukon, all along the Alaska Panhandle, that's high Hawaii over there, and it is stunning. If you've ever been to the West Coast, if you've ever been to the North Coast, it is incredible. It's unbelievably beautiful, and the riding is about a third of the province, so 330,000 square kilometers, which makes it bigger than Poland. Yeah, we're bigger than Poland. We say that a lot. It's in all of our tourism literature. It's very attractive. Oh, this is a place that's bigger than Poland. We should go. What it also is the home to some of the most incredibly powerful First Nations anywhere in the world. The Haida, the Haisla, the Taku River Tlingit up in the north, Tsimshian, the Niska. All within this riding. Much of the case law that has been moving rights and titles forward, that argument, is generated out of the northwest of British Columbia. Incredibly rich and diverse culture, incredibly strong politics, and fascinating politics as well. I should make one small note that I know there was some confusion about time. Some folks got a notice that we originally put out saying it was 7:30, and then some got 7. So there may be a few folks trickling in as we go, which is great, because they'll just join in the conversation. Here's what I was thinking of for this evening. First part is to sort of get us to where we are right now. I don't want to assume everybody has the same level of knowledge about the electoral reform. Aaron explained a bit of it, but a very 20,000 foot sort of view of things, how we got to here. And the second part is very much about how do we fix where we're at, because we're in a bit of a mess when it comes to the prospects and progress around this issue, which I see as a fundamental issue to the government that formed a year and a half ago. It was a fundamental promise to me and to many others, and it was a very clear one. We have two things that I'd like folks to take away with tonight, if nothing else sticks. One is, as I've toured, this is my third national tour on electoral reform. I did one prior to the committee forming, I did one with the committee, going to every province and territory, and this is the third time. And I was born and raised in Toronto. I wasn't born in the north of British Columbia. And being from Toronto, I was a Leaf fan. And being a Leafs fan teaches you certain lessons in life about the need to keep trying despite sometimes not succeeding. I heard a great thing. I was out I jogging the other day, and a song I heard a million times, there was a line in the middle of it I hadn't caught before, and it said, "Don't let the victories go to your head, and don't let the defeats go to your heart." I really like that. I see a lot of my colleagues in politics miss that lesson sometimes. They get really into the victories, and they start to think of themselves in wonderful ways. Every MP I've ever met, they got elected on their sheer brilliance. It wasn't the party leader or the wave or anything. No, it was me, consistent. And I've also seen, because we have fought a number of battles that we have not won, taking defeats into our hearts and allowing it to affect how we feel about politics, how we feel about our neighbors, how we feel about the government and other things. And I will admit, as this process went sideways, it actually affected how I felt about things. And I got kind of ticked off, which is usually the reverse of being really sad. An effect of like super disappointed, and I got a bit angry. So if we do that, hopefully we'll get through in about an hour, an hour and 15, give or take. And the coffee is almost brewed in the really big pot. And I should have warned you, if you took it from the small pot, that was decaf. So I don't want. I know. Look at the face. Oh my God! I feel like I've been duped. I wonder what was wrong with this. I don't know. I'm not feeling my head. That's okay, we'll rock on. Welcome in. Come on in. The seats all over. Maybe we can slide some seats back too. So let's identify what the problem is first. We don't want to assume everybody knows what it is. So here it is. We have the first past the post voting system. We are super familiar with it. We've had it for 150 years. Who wins in an election? Yeah. If the three of you are running, who's the winner?
First past the post.
What does that mean? What does that mean?
Most votes,
how many more votes?
Plus one.
Plus one, yeah, plus one. Not 50, plus one, right?
Any more.
We have MPs in the House that got around 28% of the vote in their ride, meaning 72% of the people there didn't want them. We have other people who ran, got 46% of the vote, and didn't. Two horse race, one horse, that's 3-5, one horse race. That happens sometimes. So that's the system we know. It's the system we've grown accustomed to, and yet that system has some inherent problems with it. So describing the problem quite quickly is that in the last two majority elections, Harper and Trudeau both got a little less than 40% of the vote, almost the exact same percentage, which is fascinating. Yet that translated into more than 50% of the seats, and under our system of governance, the Westminster model, if you got more than 50% of the seats, you get 100% of the power. A Canadian prime minister with a majority government, far more powerful than a US president of equivalence under other systems. Appoint Supreme Court justices, all the committees at parliament. If you are disciplined as a party, you pass every vote on budgets and laws that you want, if you're willing to push on your agenda. And so that problem creates what we call false majorities. Since the end of World War II, Canada has only had two true majority governments, where the government getting more than 50% of the votes got more than 50% of the seats. Does anyone know who they were?
Mulroney.
Yes.
Deaconator.
Yeah. Interesting examples of those that were, the two only that were able to gain that level of support. Parliament, by the way, is coming up on its 100th anniversary of studying this issue. 97 years ago now, Parliament first took up the question of changing the voting system, because about 100 years ago, we stopped having just two parties running in elections. First past the post, if there's just two of you, you kind of, it makes intuitive sense. You got more, okay, you're the winner, even if it's close. But when you get three, four, five parties running, it stops making sense because you get these distortions. This is what one of the experts told the committee is a badly behaving system. This is what the voters tell us, and this is what the system comes out with. Right? This is what we want. This is what you get. And you're happy if you were in that cohort. Right? But if only 40% gets you 100%, and only about 60 to 70% of Canadians actually vote, that means of the voting age population in this country, you need about 25% to get a majority government. What's the problem with that? Why is that a concern? If you need a quarter of the population at any time, why is that an issue? Or is it? If you were a political strategist, if you were working for the parties, what does that mean to you? What do you need to do? Go for fringe votes, go for 25%. And if you can't reach the other 75, irrelevant. And voters shouldn't be irrelevant. Right? At whether you voted for the government or not, your issue should matter to the government of the day, yeah, in one way or another. So, what proportional is one of the solutions that's on offer tries to do is something pretty simple. And forgive me, there's folks in the room that know more about this than I'll ever know. I'm going to go quick on this. It tries to translate the votes, the percentage, into seats, which then translates into the power that we hold. So if you get 25% of the vote, you get about 25% of the seats, which means you get about 25% of the power. It's more intuitive, perhaps, but it's shocking to people who only know first past the post. When I explain this to kids in high school or even lower grades, they assume this is the way the system does work. Because why would it work any other way? And the word they use all the time is fairness. It should get all the power if you only get a bit of the support. And it should be more fair. Okay. So, this is the last election. This is called voting effort. If you take all the votes that each party got, and you divide that by the number of seats each party got, this is what happened. And 2015 was not unusual. This is pretty typical. For every 38,000 votes for a Liberal, you got an MP. To get a Conservative, you needed an extra 20,000 plus votes. For a New Democrat or a Bloc, a further 20,000 votes elected each one, and the winner or loser in this particular exercise is 603,000 votes elected a single Green. 600,000 to 38,000. You can see the disparity of fairness. In Canada right now, in this Parliament, ranked 64th in the world for electing women. The Prime Minister got great accolades for a gender-balanced cabinet because it's 2015, he said. Well, the percentage change from the Harper majority to the Trudeau majority in terms of Parliament, in terms of women, does anyone know what the percentage change was? 1% up, not even a full percent, 0.8 to be precise. But yet the feel of the government and the narrative. So that's, and 2015 was not all that unusual. And it changes around. In a previous election, it would have been much, much easier to vote and get a Conservative in. For the NDP in 2011, when the Orange Wave was happening and through Quebec, we were greatly over-advantaged in our vote effort in Quebec. We got way more MPs than Quebecers actually were intending to send. Almost all of them were NDP. The various elections, that happens. So let's go through the timeline super quick. There was a promise made prior to the election, during the election, and then after the election, that said, and this is the Prime Minister now, saying, we need to know that when we cast the ballot, it counts. That when we vote, it matters. I'm proposing that we make every vote count. Thank you, Fair Vote Canada, because that was their line. That, the 2015 election, will be the last election under the first past the post system. Anyone heard that promise? There was a young intern in my office who wondered, one day he walked in and said, I just came from the Prime Minister's speech. This was back in November, December. He said, I wonder, he seems to repeat that a lot. I wonder how many times he said it. And I said, wow, that's a great question. Why don't you go find out? And the kid was like, oh, damn, I forgot the golden rule. Don't ask open-ended questions like that. So off he went. 4 or 5 weeks later, came back and said, I'm not counting anymore. But I stopped at 1,625 times. Unique times. 1,625. To media, to public town halls, in the House of Commons. Repeated, repeated, repeated. What? Why was it repeated so often? People wanted it. Unless politicians are in the habit of repeating things that people hate. I really hate voters. Did I mention that? Sure do. Can't stand any of you. No. Politicians tend to say and then certainly repeat things that they believe to be popular. Second is he was asked a lot about it. In town halls, in passing, in columns, in journals of newspapers. So, he wins. Great. And now he's the Prime Minister. And part of the promise was to form a committee. And it should have been the first indication we were in trouble when it took 8 months to make a committee. We know how to make committees in Parliament. We actually like making them sometimes. Sometimes we make committees, we're not even sure why. They're easy to make. But 8 months in, we had nothing. And a few months before that, when we were sitting there wondering what the heck's going on, one of my colleagues, a new MP from Winnipeg, Daniel Lake, son of Bill. Kind of looks like Bill a little. We were sitting in the House of Commons and he says, what's going on with your file? And I said, not much. And he said, we should propose something. We should make the committee. And I said, okay, how? What would it look like? And he says, well, it should look like how people voted in the last election. And I said, oh, Daniel, you're so young. No, that's not going to happen. But it's an interesting idea, because if the thing we're trying to fix is the broken voting system, why not use a model that shows what it might look like to fix it? So we got literally out the back of one of the bills in the House of Commons that day, and we sketched it out. You take a typical committee, and you break it down roughly how people vote, and you end up with 5 Liberals, you end up with 3 Conservatives, 2 New Democrats, and a Bloc and a Green. Now, those last two are kind of important, because the way our committees are right now, the Bloc and the Greens never have any seats, because they're not officially recognized parties. They don't have enough seats. But if you're going to talk about how you play the game, how the rules of engagement are going to be about voting, how do you not include them with a vote in the process, even though they're opponents? So we offered it to government, and we color-coded it, too. Look, we showed them, this is the vote, and that's the committee. They look kind of similar. And the government ignored us. And we said, well, let's do a citizens' assembly. Let's get Canadians, average Canadians, to guide the process. And they said, thanks for the suggestion. And then nothing happened. And then, 8 months in, they popped up and said, here's the committee. It will be composed of 7 Liberals, 2 Conservatives, and a New Democrat. Thank you. And had a press conference. And what did the journalists at the press conference ask? Why have you stacked the committee? What's the problem with a stacked committee like that? On this issue, what's the problem? What risks do you run?
Status quo.
Yeah. Status quo, that would be one risk. What else?
Not if you're the party in power.
What do you mean, not if you're the party in power?
No risk.
No risk.
Exactly.
Right, because you can, if you wish to, guide the outcome. And as committees, we always meet in secret to deliberate recommendations, because you never know who voted for what. And so then the stars kind of lined up a little bit, as sometimes happens. Other events took place. On a Monday, the government almost lost one of their bills. They didn't know how Parliament worked. And so we spooked them, almost stole a bill. And so then they reacted, overreacted. They brought in motion number 6 that said, the government will control Parliament. Totally. The passage of bills, the timing, prorogation, all of it will be handed down from government. We will shut off debate whenever we want. Whoa, it was the nuclear option of Parliament. I actually bumped into Stephen Harper on my way out that day. He was still an MP and was showing up from time to time. And I said, Stephen, in your darkest hours, did you ever think of something like this? And he said, you know,
yes.
I didn't. Man, those are some good ideas. This is dangerous. And then the next day, there was an elbow situation happened on the floor of the parliament, and everybody freaked out, and government was kind of like not on track, and they needed something to get on track. And so they dusted off our committee proposal, and to their credit, they picked it up and said, let's work together on this issue. With a committee where no one party can get all that they want. Good. Where the Greens and the Bloc have representation, and we have to work together to come up with a result. And here, off we go. Erie, we called it Erie, we thought it sounded cool. The Electoral Reform Committee, Reform Electoral. And we toured the country, went to every province, as Aaron said, we came here, kicked off here, and went to every province and territory. Open mics, town halls, online consultation, submissions. I have 180 electoral systems on my desk in Ottawa that Canadians sent me, invented. Some of them are that big on their own. Incredible. We spent $600,000 on them, inviting experts from around the world. By Skype, and every Canadian we could find who knew something about this. And we produced a 333-page report on electoral reform. And the government did what with it? What was the reaction? Does anyone remember back? This was in December.
They insulted the committee.
How did they insult the committee?
They basically said they did a lousy job.
Yes. Yes. They said, you failed. You didn't do your job. You didn't do the hard work. And I was asking a question that day in question period. And my first question was super hopeful. Hey, we finished our work together. Let's get started on the recommendations. And the government said, the minister at the time, Minister Monsef, said, you failed. And usually, and I had a rebuttal that day, usually you know, you can anticipate what the government's going to say, because they usually say the same thing most days. And I didn't anticipate that. And my answer back was something like, thanks for the feedback, I guess. Because I'd never seen that before. I'd never seen the government just poop on a report that we'd worked on really hard, and Canadians had really poured their hearts into. We had people crying in microphones. It was incredible. Talking about voting, talking about how much they cared about our democracy. It was wonderful. It was a privilege as a member of that committee to bear witness to all this. So, they dug on their own, and then they launched their own consultation. MyDemocracy.ca. Anyone remember MyDemocracy.ca?
Postcards. Yes.
It's kind of like a punchline if you were like a political comic. Hey, how about that MyDemocracy.ca? Oh, man. How many people either filled it out or tried to fill it out? Everyone got postcards and stuff in the mail? $3.5 million was spent on that exercise. What was the problem?
It was like a high school guidance test.
A high school guidance test is an interesting way to describe it. Why was it feeling like a high school guidance test?
The answers didn't go anywhere.
What's that?
The answers didn't go anywhere well, important.
Right. It's hard to divine where the answers could go.
It was leading.
It was leading? Yeah?
They gave you this weird like BuzzFeed thing. Like, are you a guardian? Are you a... That was really...
Yeah. Are you a guardian? Are you an innovator? Are you Gryffindor? Like it was this process at the end of like, I'm an innovator. I don't. It sounds nice. What is that in terms of voting systems? What am I? And what do I want? It was a hard thing to answer in some cases. It had a lot of those even if questions. Would you like this even if that? And usually it was a positive hooked with a negative. How do you answer that? Would you like an ice cream cone? Even if I kick you in the head. And it's like, I want to say I like ice cream, but I don't want to say I want to kick in the head. How do I answer your question? If I answer no, then does that mean I don't like ice cream? Because I do. So $3.5 million later, it was done over Christmas, you know, December through Christmas, always a good time to survey people. I asked the new minister a few weeks ago, I said, were you able to use anything out of that survey? And she said, we found it a very interesting exercise. Usually if I float $3.5 million, I want something more than very interesting. I want a good time. They were unable to use anything from that survey. Yes?
They want ranked ballots.
Yeah, listen, so One of the things that was challenging through this whole process, oh, let me talk about what the report said. It said a few things that are important. We studied online voting, mandatory voting, lowering the voting age. We studied voting systems. It's the most comprehensive report on Canadian democracy we've ever done. Like, we looked through all of it, suffrage, the history of how we got here, voting options, systems, we did it all. And we were explicitly asked not to pick a system, by the way. So when they said you failed, it was weird. It was like, well, why did you put it in the job description? Why did you tell us not to do this thing and then yell at us for not doing the thing? I've had employers like that. So the key recommendation about voting systems, there's two main families of voting systems. There's ones that are called majoritarian, first past the post, alternative vote, which is first past the post, but you rank your choices, right, 1 through 5. It's kind of like how parties pick leadership candidates, right? They're running. Does anyone get 50% plus one on the first ballot? Nope. Okay, knock off the loser at the end, sorry, the last place finisher, and then redistribute the votes. Take all their votes and redistribute them. Did anyone now? Nope. Knock somebody out. Survivor, right? Works fine for that choice of picking a leader. Works terrible for picking MPs, it turns out. And that was the evidence at the committee. It got crushed. The Liberals, who wrote their own report, didn't even recommend. Like, it was just destroyed in terms of outcomes. Because the question was, what are you trying to fix? And we said, we're trying to make sure that every vote counts. And the political scientists and the pollsters said, well, if that's your goal, alternative vote, ranking within a first-past-the-post system, makes the problem actually worse in terms of voters having their vote count. Because you're meant to be satisfied that your third or fourth choice was your first choice. And it's like, well, no, they were my fourth. What? Why am I happy? I'm not happy. I'm still dissatisfied. So the other family of voting systems are called proportional. And there's myriad choices in there. Single transferable vote, STV, mixed member vote. Tons. And most countries, most free democracies use those. Australia's lower house uses alternative vote. And Papua New Guinea, maybe. Someone said that last night in Vancouver. I gotta fact check that. That might be an alternative fact. Anyways, it's not used almost anywhere. The Prime Minister has since come out and said that was the one he liked. The other thing we heard was that alternative vote greatly favors centrist parties. God, let me think. Anyways. That's another voting system. So the committee went through all the evidence. 90% of the experts that testified recommended proportional voting systems. 88% of Canadians who spoke to the committee through open mics, through letters, through the online survey, recommended proportional voting systems. Overwhelming. In terms of evidence, that's what the report says. And the Conservatives signed on to that, as did the Bloc, as did the Green, and as did the NDP. And trust me when I say this, there's very little in the universe that the Bloc, Conservatives, Green, and NDP agree on. If you ask us what time it is, we'll get four different answers. I guarantee.
Different time zones for the parties.
Policy, major policy. So I saw that as a real victory, which is what the committee was trying to do, is find that rare and sacred ground where there's common agreement on things.